Hello, in this video, we're going to be breaking down holding the breath in breathwork, all the main purposes and objectives for achieving different outcomes. There are three main functions when it comes to holding the breath. One is pressure regulation, one is cerebrospinal fluid flow, and one is carbon dioxide tolerance. When it comes to pressure regulation, there are two main ways that we can affect pressure. For example, if I take a very deep, sharp breath and then tense my abdominal muscles, this will create internal pressure, which will make my blood pressure go up simply because I'm pushing the blood. However, the opposite can be achieved if we do a deep, slow inhale, hold the breath and slow down the inhale without any ab contractions. This allows our body to tap into the parasympathetic nervous system and achieve relaxation. Number two was cerebrospinal fluid flow. I have a whole video about cerebrospinal fluid, so if you haven't watched already, check it out. In essence, when we increase our negative pressure, we allow the cerebrospinal fluid to flow from the brain down to the spine. And when we do active contractions which increase the pressure, for example abdominal muscle contractions, this creates pressure which allows the cerebrospinal fluid to flow from base of the spine back up to the brain. And lastly, CO2 tolerance. When we incorporate holding the breath into our breath work, this makes our diffusion process within the blood more efficient with the oxygen it currently has in the bloodstream, rather than constantly supplying new fresh oxygen. This is especially beneficial for athletes which do endurance exercises such as long distance running. You're gaining the same energy output based on a lower oxygen input. When it comes to holding the breath, I like to think of it as two main types. There is the active holding the breath and the passive. The passive is mainly used for relaxation and is where you don't do any extra steps. For example, I take a deep breath and then I just close my air vent, not allowing any air to come up. We're not adding any extra step. We're just adding a little pause in our breathing, which is one step closer to tapping into the parasympathetic nervous system. Two is the active breath hold. We take a deep inhale and we do something with our abdominal and pelvic floor muscles. There is two main things we can do. We can either expand our muscles further, which increases the volume in our rib cage, which decreases the pressure, or we can contract our abdominal and pelvic floor muscles, which increases the pressure directly and stimulates the different flows within our body, whether it's blood flow, whether it's cerebrospinal fluid flow. When it comes to holding the breath, the natural way is to just expand. So for example, I'll take a deep, deep breath, and on the hold, I don't let my muscles go down. And then in fact, I expand them further. The opposite side is the contraction. So I take a deep breath. And now instead of pushing my abs out, I'm gonna contract them as much as I can. With the second one, my face went a bit red. That is because I now created pressure which shoots blood directly back up to the brain. It's all about understanding internal pressures, my friends. It's important to understand you can hold the breath both after an inhale or after an exhale. The exhale is harder and it has a different purpose. When we do an inhale and then we hold the breath, we build CO2 tolerance. However, we have a lot of oxygen in our lungs, which still is getting absorbed as we hold the breath, which makes it a bit easier. If I take a deep breath and just close my air vent, you will see my lungs slowly go down. As you can see, I just done a passive hold and my lungs with a full expansion were about here, and then they slowly, gradually reduced. The physical body difference won't be that noticeable. However, it's important that you know it's happening. And the main reasons for holding the breath after the exhale is mainly to build CO2 tolerance as well as build willpower, because our body will want to naturally just breathe in because we need oxygen supply. However, you are commanding your mind, no, I'm in control and you will not inhale because I am commanding you to. And that's how we gain that mental resilience on top of the CO2 tolerance benefit. One common mistake is people try to energize the body while being relaxed, or they try to get into a relaxed meditative state while having the body active, simply because they just don't understand the difference of what is it they're doing and why they are doing it. Another thing I would like to point out, many people asked me, is how long I can hold my breath for. People are just drawn towards being able to hold the breath for as long as you can. That is simply not beneficial for you. When you go beyond that 30 second mark, you're not really gaining much out of it unless you're trying to push for the extreme CO2 tolerance levels. But other than that, you're gonna be benefiting yourself much more just resetting the breathing cycle for whatever breathwork you're doing, rather than just trying to take a deep breath and trying to hold it for as long as you can. Because the reality is, not only are you stopping your optimum benefits, you're also endangering yourself in the possibility of actually damaging your brain by cutting out the oxygen supply for too long of a period of time. Me personally, I don't really try to hold the breath for as long as I can, just because I know it's just not beneficial. Obviously, you can do some experimentation, you know, exhale everything, see how much you can survive without any oxygen and building up that CO2 tolerance. However, at your own risk, and it should be done once you're a bit more advanced. You definitely shouldn't be trying to do stuff like this at the very beginning of your journey. Right, so when it comes to slow inhale, holding the breath, there's many different techniques, but they all strive to achieve the same thing. Stuff like box breathing, which is inhale for 4, hold for 4, exhale for 4, hold for 4, and repeat. We have inhale, hold, exhale for a specific duration, whether it's 5 seconds, 6 seconds, or we have inhale, exhale, hold. All these three variations, they all strive to achieve the same thing. They're adding a hold into our breathing pattern, which allows us to tap into the parasympathetic nervous system. At the end of the day, it's just learning how to control pressure and learning how to modify different breathing steps to achieve the desired outcome. Instead of me just telling you some technique for relaxation, I would rather just explain to you what is it that you're doing, so you understand why you're doing these techniques, which allows you to gain more out of these techniques and achieve the results quicker, because you're not just following steps. You actually know what is it you're doing when you're holding the breath. I hope this video will give you the understanding you need to not make that mistake anymore and navigate a bit more clearer in the breathwork space. When we want to energize our body, we make sure we're active, we make sure we're breathing nice deep, and we make sure our muscles are being activated, creating more pressure, stimulating the cerebrospinal fluid flow. However, when we want to get in deep meditative state, we're not going to be taking sharp deep inhales and then, you know, contracting our muscles, because that's simply not what we're trying to achieve. Now you will know what you're doing, when you're doing it, why you're doing it, based on the outcome you want to achieve with your breathwork session, whether it's box breathing, the 4-7-8 method, whether it's the inhale exhale hold method. They all aim to achieve the same thing, in my opinion, and that is tapping into the parasympathetic nervous system. All these ratios, they're not really relevant as long as you're holding the breath and slow down the inhale and exhale for the sake of relaxation. And obviously, when you're trying to energize yourself, you're taking the deepest breaths you possibly can, engaging that internal pressure in aiding the cerebrospinal fluid flow and much more. Thank you for watching. I hope this was insightful. See you next time.